Hello, welcome to MCN and the new for 2021 Ducati Monster. There's two big questions here really. The first is, what's it like? And the second is this bike still a Ducati Monster? Because this is the biggest step away from the bike's original design that there's ever been. It's the biggest shake-up in the model's 28-year history. There's no more trellis frame, and for the first time in any Monster model lineup, there isn't an air-cooled bike. So the new Monster uses the 937cc V-twin that's used in the Hypermotard and the Supersport 950, and what there is of the frame is the aluminium front frame from the Panigale Superbike. In terms of chassis geometry, it's not that different to the outgoing 821 model, but the new bike's got a much higher centre of gravity, taller seat, and it feels completely different. It's night and day to any Monster we've seen so far. And it's the handling that's perhaps the most impressive thing. The bike feels really light on its tyres. At 188 kilograms wet, that's around the same as is claimed for the Yamaha MT-09. And Ducati's claimed weight is near enough exactly the same as for a KTM 890 Duke. And the bike feels far more agile than previous Monsters. The old bikes definitely handled, they weren't ill-handling motorcycles, but previous Monsters have all sat quite low, and so while they've been agile at low speed, that low weight between your ankles making them easy to manoeuvre, at speed they could take a little bit of muscle. There was also a thing with the air-cooled bikes, especially the 620s and bikes of that era, that there was a kind of wobble to the chassis. It's not that they were unstable, it's not that they were wriggling, but hit bumps mid-turn with some lean on, and the bike just felt insecure in that it wasn't fully sucked down to the tarmac. And all that's gone with the new bike. It's so nimble, so agile. The steering is light and accurate and precise, and it maintains that accuracy right up to way beyond the speed limit. The 43mm front forks and the rear shock don't have adjustable damping, there's only rear preload, but it would be wrong to lazily call these parts budget. It's good quality suspension. The ride's quite sporty, it's a little bit jiggly on badly surfaced roads, and on bumpy B roads you're aware that it's a sportily set up bike, but the damping quality is really good. Hit a pothole and it just absorbs the imperfection, doesn't really pass anything on. It's good quality damping. The suspension really helps bring out the best of the brakes as well. The Brembo front calipers are really, really powerful, but with the Monster's riding position, which is quite dominant and you feel in control of the front end, there's a real smooth action to the forks when you brake hard and a fantastic connection to the tyre, and you can just stop it on its nose. You pull the lever, it dips a controlled amount, bang, you've stopped. Really, really impressive. Better than any superbike, I reckon. Obviously, being 2021 means you get lots of electronics. There's 3-level ABS and 8-level traction control and a separate wheelie control, so you can set the Monster up so that there's no tyre slip, but still allow the front to lift under acceleration, which is good. It's nice to be able to separate those functions. It's also got Ducati Power Launch. So you'll have seen MotoGP riders on the grid, in gear, nail the throttle and just measure the power out with the clutch. And there's a 3-level system on the Monster that does that. It's a little bit of a gizmo. You've got more control feeding the throttle in manually, and it's a little bit disconcerting when the engine's stuttering off the rev limiter and you've got the throttle to the stop and you're simply controlling the clutch. It works, but it's a little bit of a gimmick. The Desmodromic V-twin has 4 valves per cylinder and makes a claimed 109 horsepower, which is close enough to rivals like the MT-09 and the 890 Duke. It also makes exactly the same amount of torque as the MT-09, but delivers it a little bit earlier in the revs. And compared to the outgoing 821 model, the new Monster's peak torque arrives 1250 RPM earlier. And that makes a real difference. It means the bike's more flexible, there's easier access, roll-on drive, and because Ducati have used sensible road-biased gearing, the bike's really, really perky. Really perky. You can be in any gear, stop worrying about revs, and just get on with riding the thing. Ducati's focus on improving the bottom end of mid-range doesn't mean that it's not fun up top though. There is still a top-end rush. Get the engine revving and it'll lift the front wheel and it fires forward. And again, because it's on snappy gearing, it feels quite exciting. Sort of brap, 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 and through the gears, it's a fast motorcycle. And because it's a modern Ducati, you've not got to worry about servicing like you did with the older ones. Oil services are 9,000 miles with a valve check at the major service at 18,000, which is more than acceptable. On a mix of typical British roads, you'll get around 50 to the gallon, and it's a 14 litre tank, which means over 150 mile range, which again, for a naked bike, that's as far as you want to go before you want to get off and have a stretch. The colour TFT dash uses a display that's based on the Panigale layout, and it's easy to read, it's attractive, and there's plenty of information. The bike's also got self-cancelling indicators, which sweep like on an Audi car, which I find a bit pretentious, but I'm sure people will love them. The indicator switch itself is also used to go through three riding modes, and it's also used to reset the trip, which is fine, but because the indicators turn themselves off, my 30 years of riding experience, I still manually go to turn the indicators off, even though they've stopped winking on their own, which means that I come out of a junction and find I'm resetting the trip when I don't want to. It's not a biggie, but it is quite annoying. Though it's taller than the departing 821, the 820mm seat height doesn't make the Monster unmanageable. The bike's very slim in the middle. Just using the aluminium front frame means that the widest point at the bike's waist is the rear cylinder. So it's really, really easy to get a foot down. And because the bike's light, and because the steering's so easy and accurate at low speed, it feels really manageable. Comfort's good. You sit a bit closer to the bars than on previous Monsters. And taking into account that it's a naked bike, so there's always going to be wind blast, it's easy enough to see off a tank full, no problem. So what Ducati have done is modernise a model that was getting a little bit dated, and the revisions have brought the bike right up to date with the MT09 and the 890 Duke, and it's certainly far more fun than something like a street triple. It's lighter, it's easier to ride, it's more nimble. Ducati's phrase, their marketing phrase, is just fun, and it's really, really fitting. It does beg the question though, is it still a Monster? You haven't got a trellis frame, there isn't an air-cooled option, and that feel of the previous models isn't really there with the new one. The original M900 Monster from 1993 came about when its designer Miguel Galuzzi saw a poster of a stripped-down 851 superbike in a Japanese magazine. He thought that was the bike he wanted to make. He fell in love with it, printed out an A3 copy, stuck it on his studio wall. That's the bike he wanted. He wanted to create a motorbike that didn't have plastics, that didn't have all the pointless race replica stuff, because you don't need it on the street. Ducati were owned by Kajiva at the time, and when he mentioned it to his boss, Massimo Bordi, who was the bloke in charge of Ducati, he was told, maybe one day, but not now. However, Galuzzi was going on holiday and was asked if he could do some sketches and take some parts and have a bit of a play. And Bordi said, yeah, help yourself. So he went to the Ducati factory and he took the frame from an 851 and planned to use the engine from the 888 Superbike, which had just been launched. They ended up using the air-cooled 2-valve per cylinder engine from the 900SS because that wasn't selling very well at the time. They were tripping over the things on the factory floor. And the advantage there, of course, as well, was that there was no radiator, which helped with the stripped down look. And the bike needed a smaller battery than the larger one that was needed on the injected 851 and 888 models. Galuzzi actually worked on his prototypes in a shed down by the lake, away from the Kajiva factory. It was a bit of a secret. No one really kind of knew what he was doing because he was supposed to be based elsewhere, working on official projects. When Castiglione, the owner of the Cajiva brand, realised that he was doing something he perhaps shouldn't be, he walked into the shed, saw the bike and said, "Is that it? Is there not something missing?" Such was Galuzzi's design, with such minimal bodywork. There was a craze in Italy at the time called Monster in my pocket, and children were buying little boxes with Monster written on them, with little rubber toy monsters inside. And when Galuzzi would get home at night, his children would pester him, "Dad, Dad, Monster, Monster, Monster," because they wanted these toys. When they decided to first show the model, their new model, to the Cajiva board and then plan to take it to a bike show, they didn't have a name. And so Galuzzi said to Bordi, "Let's just call it Monster." And he said, "You can call it what you want." And that's where the name came from. It was never Mostro or Monstro. It was always Monster, because that was what it said on the kids' toy box. There was resistance at the Ducati factory when they first started doing prototypes. They saw themselves as a company that did sports bikes and race bikes, and one of the prototypes ended up painted green, referred to as Kermit, with great big pullback chopper-style handlebars. And Galuzzi was not too chuffed when he dropped in to see how development was going. But the model was a massive hit for Ducati. This is the bike that kept them going through the 1990s. They've sold more than 300,000 of the things over the years. And in 1999, a Monster was Italy's best-selling motorcycle, the first time a Ducati had ever headed the sales chart in their home country. After the success of the Monster during the 1990s, Ducati got a little bit carried away in the 2000s. Bikes like the S4 that was launched in 2001 looked impressive on paper with a 916 engine and fancy suspension, but they moved away from what had made the Monster such a hit. Chasing performance, fancy suspension, big engines, all well and good, but the bike lost that simple charm that had made the original M900 and other air-cooled derivatives so appealing. And that's why I think the new Monster is still a Monster. It's true to Galuzzi's original concept. It's a simple motorbike. It's an engine, barely any frame, two wheels, minimal bodywork, and it's full of rider involvement and engagement. You feel really connected to what's happening. So yeah, I think it is still a Monster, despite the fact it hasn't got a trellis frame, and despite the fact it doesn't ping after you've given it a good thrash. I think they've got it pretty much spot on.